I have a disease where my body's immune system attacks my own tissues. It affects me every day. The brain fog, the joint pain, the dryness. Some days I can't even get out of bed.
But you don't look sick. What exactly is Sjogren's syndrome?
Sjogren's syndrome is an autoimmune disease. It's similar to lupus or multiple sclerosis. It affects the moisture-producing glands. So it's where the immune system attacks something foreign in your body. And in our case, Sjogren's, it attacks the moisture-producing glands and starts to shut them all down. Most people are familiar with some moisture-producing glands, tears or saliva, but they aren't familiar that the entire body has moisture glands in them, for your lungs, your liver, your pancreas, your joints, all needing moisture to operate correctly. So when the disease attacking all the moisture-producing glands starts to shut all those internal organs down, as well as all the other processes that you know of, tears, saliva, etc.
The most common symptoms of Sjogren's syndrome are dry eyes, dry mouth, fatigue, and arthritis or musculoskeletal pain.
How do you diagnose Sjogren's syndrome?
Sjogren's syndrome is a very difficult disease to diagnose. It often takes 6 or 7 years between the time that symptoms begin and the time the diagnosis is made. And one reason for this is that it affects so many different organs. So in order to diagnose Sjogren's, you need to perform an entire battery of tests. You need to do tests to look for objective evidence of dry eyes. You need to do tests to look for objective evidence of dry mouth. And you need to do tests to look for autoimmunity. And the tests for autoimmunity are usually the blood test or a small biopsy of the salivary glands in the lower lip to look for inflammation of the glands. And it's a composite of various tests that is used to make the diagnosis.
So who gets Sjogren's syndrome?
Sjogren's syndrome is now considered to be the second most common autoimmune rheumatic disease in the world, affecting as many as 3 to 4 million people in this country, and 90% of them are women. The majority of women affected are women in the 40 to 55 year old age range. However, as we get better at diagnosing Sjogren's, we're now able to make this diagnosis in younger and younger women. In men, about 10% of the patients are men, and sometimes even in children.
In fact, over 4 million Americans have Sjogren's, which is more than breast cancer affects the U.S. each year.
Are there different types of Sjogren's syndrome?
There are two different types of Sjogren's syndrome. The term primary Sjogren's syndrome refers to a person who was previously healthy, then develops dry eyes, dry mouth, and other symptoms, undergoes a diagnostic evaluation and is told that they have primary Sjogren's. It's not associated with any other underlying autoimmune or connective tissue diseases at the time of diagnosis. The term secondary Sjogren's syndrome refers to someone who already has an established autoimmune or connective tissue disease, such as rheumatoid arthritis or lupus or scleroderma. They may have this for several years and then become dry and start developing other symptoms, undergo a diagnostic evaluation, and at that time will be given an additional diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis complicated by secondary Sjogren's. And the term secondary implies that the inflammation spread from the initial target organ to the moisture-producing glands.
Is there a cure? What treatments are there?
Right now, we don't have a cure for Sjogren's syndrome. However, with more research and awareness, I have no doubt that in the near future that will change. We do, however, have plenty of treatments that can help people. We have treatments for dry eyes, such as artificial tears and eye drops for eye inflammation. We have treatments for dry mouth, such as medications like sevimeline or prilocarpine, which stimulate saliva flow. We have a variety of products that can replace the lack of saliva, artificial salivas, moisturizing gels, and gums and lozenges that can be helpful in stimulating saliva flow and alleviating symptoms in the mouth.
Why haven't I heard of Sjogren's?
84% of Americans had never heard of Sjogren's before, so it's so important that we increase awareness around the country by doing various awareness events, by patients sharing their stories with family and friends and neighbors, and just being involved in community activities to make sure that people know how prevalent Sjogren's is.
We do quite a few things to raise awareness. One of the ways is by hosting our Sjogren's walkabouts in various cities across the nation. Sjogren's walkabouts give a patient the opportunity to talk about their disease to their friends and family members, let them know about Sjogren's, what it is, and to raise funds for research and education.
We're walking for us!
We're walking for our lives. We're not walking for her.
We walk for Team Puglisi.
We walk for Team Wade.
We walk for all Sjogren's patients.
We walk for Team JBR.
We walk for our wives.
I started with Sjogren's syndrome about 3 years ago, and I was diagnosed about 2 years ago. And from then, I've had infusions and on a lot of different medicine. And I think awareness is like important for Sjogren's because when you go to explain it to someone, nobody really knows what it is. So it's difficult to tell someone that's new about it. So Sjogren's syndrome affects my everyday life because I missed a whole year of school and I just started this year as a freshman back at school, and I never really know how I'm going to feel when I wake up. It's just kind of a day by day thing. And I just have to go with the flow, I guess.
How I got diagnosed with Sjogren's syndrome is actually kind of funny. My mom gives me the magazine Good Housekeeping every year for Christmas. And I always read it cover to cover. And when I was in my early 30s, I was reading the magazine, and way at the back, there was this little tiny square that said, "Do you have dry eyes and dry mouth?" And I was like, "Yeah, actually I do." So it had a number to call, and it was for the Sjogren's Syndrome Foundation, which of course I had never heard of. And I'm starting to get scared because I don't know what this disease is. And they told me to go to a rheumatologist. He said, "Yes, you have Sjogren's syndrome." However, he didn't offer me any treatment, and me not knowing any better and not having the internet at that point in my life, I assumed that it was like, okay, I've got Sjogren's syndrome. I didn't know it could get worse until it started getting worse. It got a little bit worse through my 30s. I kept looking for more and more information, which was without the internet at that time. I couldn't, even the medical books had like one line, like dry mouth, you know, dry eyes. I was like, oh, that's really helpful. And so when I finally got online, I found an email list and where people started talking about all these treatments and medicines and stuff. And I'm suddenly going in my head, I'm not being treated, and oh my God, I need to be treated. So I started looking for doctors that really knew what they were doing. And to be honest, I didn't find any in Vermont. When I got towards my 40s, I started to get much sicker, and I was really having a hard time between work and being sick. I would teach. I was a reading specialist in a high school and loved my job so much. I loved it so much. But I would have to come home from work and go to bed so that I could go to work the next day. Or I'd have to stay in bed all weekend so that I could teach that week. And I would still miss days. Get into my mid-40s, I really started to crash and burn, and it was a really awful decision as to working and teach, you know, trying to trying to make sure I was well enough to work, but to take care of my kids. Finally, I went to my primary care doctor, who's the most wonderful, wonderful woman in the world, most wonderful doctor, and I sat in her office crying, saying, what am I going to do? I can't, you know, my kids, my job, I feel awful. And I can remember the kindest, kindest look on her face, and she put her hand on my knee and she said, Pat, it's time to stop. I get really angry when I think about it. And I guess the biggest thing is if they had treated me from the beginning, would I still be in the classroom? Because that's where I really, really want to be.
And cut.